Arguably, the most important component of any digital camera is its sensor, because it's responsible for collecting the light that makes up the image. Now, sensor size varies dramatically from camera to camera. The biggest common size is full frame, and that is roughly the same size as the image area of 35mm film. Now, full frame sensors are found in big professional DSLRs like the Nikon D810 or the Canon 5D Mark III. And I'm just going to draw for you really quickly a scale drawing of a full frame sensor. So let's just get the size right. This is 16 times the size of a full frame sensor. Now, the next size down is APS-C. They're found in pretty much all other DSLRs. So if you've got an enthusiast or an entry level DSLR, it will have an APS-C size sensor in it. And they're also found in a lot of CSCs. And they are about that big in comparison. So you can see they're, you know, quite a bit smaller, but still relatively big sensors in the grand scheme of things. The next common size down is Micro Four Thirds. They're found in Olympus and Panasonic CSCs. And then it goes down, there's a 1-inch sensor, and there's lots of others, all the way down to a smartphone size, which is roughly that. Now, just to put a figure on it, an iPhone sensor is 50 times smaller in area than a full frame sensor. So you can see that if you're using a professional DSLR, the size of the chip that is collecting the light is much, much bigger than if you are using a smartphone. So what does that actually mean for your photography in practice when you're taking a photo? Well, actually, lots of things. And the first thing to think about is crop factor. You might have heard of it before, but I'm going to explain to you really briefly exactly what it is and why it's important. The way I'm going to illustrate this is I'm going to draw, or I'm going to try to draw, a camera. So let's just that's the lens on the end. That's not actually not bad. And then at the back of the camera, I'm going to pop my sensor. So we're going to imagine this is a full frame camera, like a 5D Mark III. Now the light is going to be coming down the lens and it's going to be striking the sensor to make the image. So something like that. Now, if I were to then say, right, I'm going to put this lens on an APS-C camera, so an APS-C sensor, which is much smaller, you can see that some of the light that the lens collects is not being collected by the sensor. So this edge bit here that would be collected if there were a full frame sensor in the camera is lost. That's called crop factor because the edge of the frame is completely cropped off. Now this means that when you use a smaller sensor, even though the focal length is technically the same, the effective focal length is different. It looks like it's zoomed in. So to illustrate that, this is being filmed on a full frame camera, a Nikon D610. If it were an APS-C camera, it would look like this. You can see the edges of the frame are cropped out, so it looks more zoomed in. Now this is really important because it means that the same lens will give a different angle of view depending on the camera that it's put on. Well, that's the theory. Let's check it out in practice. So I'm here with Louise and I've asked her to model for me, and I've got an APS-C camera. This is a Canon 80D and it has on it a 50mm lens. And I'm going to take a portrait of Louise from this position. Excuse me. Hey, I am going to take a portrait of Louise exactly the same as Tim's, absolutely identical. But I've got a full frame camera, 5D Mark III, and I've got exactly the same 50mm lens on it. Now, on account of the bigger sensor, I'm going to be much, much closer to Louise to get exactly the same composition. In other words, so that she is exactly the same size within the frame. There you go. I've got an APS-C camera. Therefore, I can be further away to get the same composition. So let's say if I want to shoot sports or wildlife photography, I can have a lens with a shorter focal length and still get the same shot. Perfect. Not quite. You see, by me being able to get closer to my subject, I can have one huge advantage over the APS-C guys, and that is that I can get a shallower depth of field.
Now, guys,
you're both right, but full frame Tim's depth of field claim definitely needs a bit more explanation. Come on, follow me.
Full frame Tim just said that his larger sensor camera gives a shallower depth of field. So let's just investigate that claim a bit further. So I've got a tape measure stuck on the wall here, and I'm positioned at 0 inches, and I'm gonna take a shot at 15 inches. So I'm gonna focus on the 15 inch marker. I'm using an aperture of f1.8 and a 50 mil focal length. As you can see, the 15 inch marker is in focus, but the 14 and the 16 inch markers are out of focus. So my depth of field is really shallow, less than 2 inches. Now, I'm gonna take another shot, but this time I'm gonna focus on the 50 inch marker, so 35 inches further away than my first shot. And I'm using exactly the same aperture and exactly the same focal length. Now, as you can see from this shot, the 50 is perfectly in focus, as are the 49 and the 51 inch markers. So we can clearly see we have a larger depth of field, much bigger than 2 inches. In other words, the closer you are to your subject, the closer you focus, the shallower the depth of field becomes. How does this relate to Tim and Tim? Well, don't forget, full frame Tim was able to stand much closer to his subject to get the same composition. So you would expect that he would have a much shallower depth of field. And that actually stacks up if you think about it, because if you've ever tried to shoot a portrait on an iPhone, which has a really tiny sensor, the depth of field is huge. It's impossible to get a blurry background. Back to you, Tim and Tim.
Okay, let's give this a go. Right, so with my full frame camera and my 50mm lens, I'm gonna shoot another portrait of Louise, but this time I'm gonna do it at f1.8, all right, Tim? So f1.8 is the widest aperture. Put you out of the way then. Oh,
sorry.
Right, f1.8. Even though the bridge appears to be closer to the subject in the APS-C image because I moved and therefore the perspective changed, in the full frame shot, it is definitely more blurry. So that's it then, proof. Sensor size does have an impact on both the effective focal length of your lenses and how shallow your depth of field is. Yeah, but is that the whole story?
No, I'm afraid it's not. Because as a general rule, the smaller the sensor, the worse its low light performance. Let's just have a look at what that means in practice. So I've got here a scale model of a full frame sensor. This is just a canvas with some green squares stuck on it. And each of the squares represents 1 megapixel. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4 by 5. This is a 20 megapixel sensor. Now, each one of these megapixels has 1 million pixels on it. So even on this scaled up model, you can see those pixels are absolutely tiny. And it's those pixels that are responsible for collecting light that makes up the image. So the bigger the pixel can be, the better its low light collecting ability will be. So that has a pretty good low light collecting ability. However, a much smaller sensor, this one is roughly the area of a Micro Four Thirds sensor in comparison to this one. And you can see that this one too has 4 by 5, 20 megapixels. So the resolution of those two sensors is identical, but the size of the pixels is really different. You can see that the Four Thirds sensor has much, much smaller pixels or megapixels than the full frame sensor. So therefore the pixels themselves are also gonna be much smaller, and therefore their light collecting ability is gonna be much less. Let's have a look at this in a different way. Now what I've got here is two kind of jam jars, and they're gonna represent single pixels. And I want you to think of them as vessels for collecting light, because that's exactly what a pixel is. It simply collects photons of light. So this one represents a pixel on a full frame camera, and this one represents a pixel on a smaller sensor camera. And as you can see, the openings at the top are very different. This is quite big, this is quite small. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna sprinkle some light onto these pixels and see how much they collect. Now, because we can't do it with light in this experiment, we're gonna use water instead, but just imagine it's light. Okay, so I'll give it a few seconds.
Right, ideal. So let's have a look.
So as you can see, there's definitely more water in the, or more light in the bigger jar than in the smaller jar because it has a bigger opening. So that is the theory, but we want to know whether this actually works in practice. So when you have a camera in your hand, is that how it actually is when you're out shooting? So what we've got is we've got two cameras, a full frame DSLR, so this is a 5D Mark III, and we've got this camera here, which is has a much, much smaller sensor, but it still has all of the manual ability of this one. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take them into a very dark place, this church, and see whether what we've looked at in theory actually stacks up in a real world shooting situation.
So I want to shoot the same image on both cameras so that I can compare the results. Now, to make this a completely fair test, I'm shooting in RAW format and I'm using the same composition for both. Now, I've set ISO to 3200 so that we can see how the two cameras perform at higher ISO settings. As you can see, the full frame camera with its big pixels has produced a relatively noise-free result. But on the smaller sensor camera, the pixels have collected less light and so the signal has had to be amplified. This has produced much more visible noise. Pixel size also affects dynamic range, which is the range of light intensity that the camera can record. Now, to illustrate this, I've taken a picture on both cameras at ISO 100, and from these, I can check the extreme highlights and shadows to see how much detail has been recorded. So, for example, when I brighten up the RAWs in editing software, I can see that there's still plenty of shadow detail on the full frame camera, but not so much on the compact. Equally, when I darken down the RAWs, I can see that within the areas of highlight, there's still plenty of information available to me on the full frame camera, but not quite so much on the compact.
So, there we have it. We have shown that the size of your camera's sensor does have an impact on the look of your images. Now, that's not to say that smaller sensor cameras can't give you amazing image quality. You know, there are lots of other factors at play that we haven't had a chance to look at today, including, you know, resolution, the camera's, you know, sensor technology, and of course the availability of wide aperture lenses on the system that you're using. But it is all food for thought the next time you invest in a camera.